League Digest. I'm Michael Adams here with Andrew Paskin, and this is part two of A Time for Heroes, our 1994 season recap. How are you, Andy?
Mate, fantastic. Pumped to be back for part two. Part one was cathartic.
Yeah, that's a good word for it. Really appreciate all the feedback from everyone. It's been very encouraging. We're going to press on with 1994 and look at the regular season. And as we like to do, we'll start with last year's premiers, which was the Broncos in this case. But there's actually not a lot to say about them because every storyline about the Broncos is a prelude to Super League. So you're going to be hearing a lot about the Brisbane season 1994. But let's just keep it to on-field. It was quickly apparent early in the year that something was off with the Broncos. They'd had to shed a couple of players. There was disharmony in some of their early season results. There were St. George and Parramatta players saying that they were surprised at how much the Broncos were sniping at each other.
It's crazy, isn't it? Considering they were back-to-back champs.
Yeah.
It really is surprising, still to this day.
Yeah. And you could see how far they'd fallen where, in June, the match of the round, Canberra versus Brisbane, actually wasn't the match of the round at all. The Broncos had fallen so far in the way they were playing that they shifted the TV game to Canterbury Norths and, you know, Canberra Brisbane, which in every other fixture is, you know, the absolute marquee, was an also-ran.
Well, that's such a fall from grace, because 93, I remember the Canberra Brisbane game on Friday Night Football when Canberra won 20-10, was an absolute must-see game. And it was giant ratings, and
yeah,
I remember clearly it was the marquee game of the year.
Yeah,
and a year later.
So among the many reasons for why they fell, one of them was a charmed injury run that they'd had, you know, in those premiership years coming to an end with a lot of injury problems early in the year, which is, it's so funny. It's historically basically impossible for teams to overcome that.
Yeah.
Like, you get two or three key injuries and you're basically done.
Also, was this the era of the decline of Willie Kahn?
It was he still had the reputation.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think it's definitely the start of it.
Because he went from premier origin test winger to where's Willie Kahn gone?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that was kind of a meteoric rise and fall. I mean, I know he had three or four, you know, good years of being a test and origin player, but he just went off the cliff.
I always find it odd when that happens.
Yeah.
Shannon Hegarty, Jack Ellsgood, just cliff.
But I wouldn't say either of those players got anywhere near the heights of Willie Kahn. Like, I remember the talk in like 92, 93. It was like, you know, he was almost up there in Renoff in the way he was being.
Yeah, that's what I mean, yeah. And I don't know if it was a desire thing or a body thing.
And it wasn't helped with a dramatic loss of form from Glenn Lazarus, who, you know, started the season overweight and out of condition. His form had deteriorated to the point where he ended up being dropped and was coming off the bench. Very, very lucky to make a kangaroo tour that year.
Glad he did.
Yeah. It goes back to the old adage, harder to get out of the team than to get in.
It would have been a legacy stopper.
Yeah.
Missed that.
Yeah. So, as it turns out, it was just a blip and he got back to best form, but I haven't really, in all the reading I've done, found a real reason for the form loss, other than that, you know, lack of condition.
Well, he was known for being an agile big man with a fast play to ball his whole career.
Mm.
So if you're not agile and a big man,
yeah,
and you play to ball slow,
yeah,
what are you?
Yeah, fair point. The other big story about Brisbane that year, who you know, did go on to scrape a place in the semi-finals and won a semi-final game. So the season wasn't a complete disaster, just a real drop-off from the previous 2 years. But they actually lost the World Club Challenge to Wigan, which was played in Brisbane mid-year. So, great time for Wigan to get Brisbane.
Yeah. It was probably one of the last victories of a English club.
Yeah, yeah. Well, actually, it was the last World Club Challenge until 97. Yeah, don't worry. We've got an episode on the 97 World Club Challenge. But yeah, so Wigan had a 20-14 victory there. Leading to an ugly scene in the dressing room after the match when Paul Morgan had some harsh words to say about the refereeing performance and told John Quayle the league was run by a bunch of crooks, to which John Quayle called Ken Arthurson over and said, "Say that in front of my chairman." which kind of shows you the tenor of the time and the way that relationship was heading.
You forget how mafia-like rugby league administration was and is. Like, yeah. Like, if you get the displeasure of the king, you could be ousted.
So that leads us to Canberra. Before we talk about their on-field, we're going to spend some time just talking about that squad. But it was almost a reversal of fortunes between Canberra and Brisbane. They'd had a pretty horrible couple of years with injuries themselves. And
brought a young man in Toronto to tears.
We've got more on that coming up soon, Andrew. Don't worry. And actually, they'd had injury problems basically throughout their whole run. So their big six from, you know, 89 onwards, Daly, Clyde, Stewart, Meninga, Belcher and Steve Walters. Steve Walters was the only one who didn't miss at least the equivalent of a year's worth of football because of an injury.
Mm.
Bradley Clyde had one season since 88 where he played more than 14 club games.
Insanity. How good was the guy that he could get away with it?
I know. And this was also the period where, you know, I think in many years, 94 was like Laurie Daly at his absolute peak. But at the same time, it was when his knee was, you know, basically falling apart. And he became a very different player in the latter half of his career because of it.
But we see with the grand final, he still had it.
Yeah, yeah.
He still had it to turn on when he wanted. Yeah. Later on, he couldn't turn on.
Yeah, definitely. And then, of course, the biggest one of all was the one that brought that Toronto boy to tears with Ricky Stewart injured late in the 93 season.
Jumped up with a horrendous tackling style, which he wouldn't cop from his own players now.
Mm.
Got brushed off for the upper body, ankle snapped.
And the fact that it was in, you know, a meaningless thrashing of Parramatta.
Why wasn't he off the field? Yeah. I could have murdered Sheen.
What was the score at the time? Like 60-0
or
something?
Yeah, it was all their stars should have been off.
Yeah.
The aftermath of that, when Sticky was involved in the understudies playing Steve Stone and Trevor Shadell, and they were trying to sell the fact that it was going to be sweet because Sticky was guiding them, it's over.
Mm. And that is really the one that got away in terms of that, you know, much anticipated grand final that we never got, Canberra versus Brisbane.
Lucky for St. George, they wouldn't have been there.
Yeah. So on top of dealing with a bad injury run, they were also dealing with the repercussions of having to rebuild their squad. Please imagine me doing giant quotation marks in the wake of the salary cap dramas.
Let's talk about this. What, 92 salary cap debacle?
Yeah, or 91.
91, yeah. So 92 was a write-off, yeah. Right? By 94, they've got, 12 internationals and about 8 future internationals.
Yeah, so this is what... When I was reading all these stories, you know, during 94 of Canberra players and coaches talking about how they had to, you know, rebuild and, you know, get some new blood in, and the salary cap tore us apart, and I was falling for it for a while. I was like, yeah, they did a really good job, like, getting that squad back. And then, okay, so here were the internationals at Canberra in 1992 after they'd had to start shedding players and rebuilding. So they had one former international in Gary Belcher, who, you know, he was so past he hadn't played a test since 1991. You know, Brad Clyde, Laurie Daly, Sean Hoppy, Mal Meninga, Ricky Stewart, Steve Walters, current internationals, Jason Croker, David Ferner, Brett Mullins, and Ken Nagus, all future internationals. So, yeah.
At least they were young, though.
Yeah, good rebuild. You know, well done, Canberra.
You look at the squad for the 94 grand final. Brett Hetherington's on the bench, and he's the weak link.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
He's like a gun.
Yeah, but let's give Tim Sheens and, you know, Canberra administration credit for the players they did bring in. You know, one of the key knocks, especially once Lazarus left, was they were a bit soft in the forwards. Well, bring in Quentin Pongia, who, as we're recording this, has just recently passed away.
Legendary hard man.
Big loss to the game. Bringing Quentin Pongia and John Lomax, that's one way to address a soft forward pack.
I mean, I always laugh when I think about how hard these guys were, especially John Lomax.
Yeah.
Pongia was the harder hitter. Lomax was just the harder lunatic.
Yeah. And then a bench of Brett Hetherington and David Wesley. You
know, It wasn't Wesley at Papua New Guinea International?
Yeah, he was, yeah.
I mean, but then they had like a young Ruben Wiki. And
yeah.
Like, so that they actually bet well on everyone they bet on.
Yeah, exactly. Getting Noah Andruku in, you know.
The original Fijian flyer.
Yeah, exactly. From the Stanley Jeans School of birth, death, and marriage record keeping. Like, Like, we were talking about it off air, like, watching that grand final, like, how is he not 40 in 1994?
I don't want to preempt the grand final talk, but, I mean, I remember him debuting with his, like, twinkle-toed stepping and just, like, bamboozling guys.
Mm.
The grand final, he's running over guys like Sammy Redrunner.
Yeah.
The strength of the guy.
Yeah.
I don't remember him being as good as he was.
No, he was a beast, no doubt about it. It's crazy to me now, looking at that team, and at the end of this 1994 recap, we're going to spend some time putting them... sorting out where they belong in the pantheon of great backlines. But it's crazy to me when I read stories from 1994, quotes like this: there are rumblings in Canberra that the Raiders are building a team to lift the Winfield Cup from Brisbane. When I look at that team, I'm like, rumblings? Like, this is like a clear premiership team. But you have to remember that a lot of these players were just making their reputations.
Yeah, yeah.
So let's start with talking about the ones who already had the big three at that time. This is how good that side is. Like, Mal Meninga isn't in your big three.
but here's the thing. It was a different era. You could have squads that had, like, a big eight, you know, but now it's only ever a big three because the salary cap's actually semi-enforced.
Yeah. So, Ricky Stewart, I think, at that point in the game was the very top of the tree.
93, he was the best player in the world.
Yeah, I think so too. And with a lot to prove in 1994, not only because of the disappointment of 1993, but with the fact that he still hadn't been picked to play halfback for Australia in Australia. So after replacing Langer on the 1990 Kangaroo Tour, Langer had got his way back to be the number one choice.
It's pre-94 tour, so 94 tour made him as a top echelon guy. So we're still in the growth phase.
So yeah, 1994 was probably the peak of Langer versus Stewart in the press, and the debate over, with the Kangaroo Tour coming up, the debate over who should be the halfback. I got to say, it seems that the opinion of the public and the players had swayed over to Ricky Stewart to the point that in the players' poll, Ricky Stewart got 69% of the vote as who should be Test halfback. Langer polled 29%.
If you look at the state of the game, as we said on episode one, from the 5 meter rule to the 10 meter rule, Daly and Stewart were even better than today, passing two passes across the entire field, basically.
Yeah.
For full width.
Yeah.
And it was unheard of, and it shaped Joey Johns. But it still hasn't been duplicated. That 7 and 6, as far as organizers go, and one of them was a gun running player as well, has never been matched.
Yeah. But just think about. And it's being talked about a lot. I'm not revealing anything new. But when you actually look at the numbers, the dominance of Brisbane and Canberra in that era. So going back to that Rugby League Week players poll, I'm just going to read out all the names of the players who were listed at each position. So at fullback, you had Brett Mullins getting 70%, Tim Brasher, Matthew Ridge, Matt Sears, Julian O'Neill. Winger, Willie Kahn getting 67%, Sean Hoppy, Michael Hancock, Ken Nagus. Centre, Steve Renoff getting 70%, then Paul McGregor and Mal Meninga. 5'8", Laurie Daly 64%, then Terry Lamb, Kevin Walters, Greg Florimo and Cliff Lyons. Halfback, Ricky Stewart getting 63%, then Alan Langer, Jason Taylor. Lock, Bradley Clyde 76%, then Brad Fittler, Mark Glanville, Brad Nakai and Jason Smith, the other named players. Second row, David Fairley 33%, Paul Sirenen, Dean Pay, Steve Menzies, Gary Larson, Paul Harrigan and Brad Clyde polling as well. Prop, Paul Harrigan, Glenn Lazarus, Ian Roberts. Hooker, Steve Walters, Jim Sidaris, Ben Elias, Kerrod Walters. The dominance of Canberra and Brisbane players in that, and how much they dominated almost every position, like getting 60-70% of the vote.
Amazing. Absolutely amazing.
So just for good measure, in that year, Brad Clyde was polled as the best player, getting 25%. Then you had Laurie Daly, Ricky Stewart, Steve Renoff, Paul Harrigan, Cliff Lyons, Brett Mullins, and Alan Langer getting the minors.
Just on Brad Clyde, I would like to hear some actual football analysts' breakdown on what made him so great.
Mm.
Because universally, no one argues about it.
No.
Was it his motor? Was it his go forward? But universally across the board, Brad Clyde was the man.
Yeah.
Just as a kid, you don't really understand.
No. I kind of went along with it because everyone said he was the best player in the world. So I was like, oh, he must be the best player in the world.
I remember he was always back with the first hit up and like, so that was more a motor thing. But I mean.
But I mean, he was definitely mobile. It's not like he was just, a battering ram, up and down. Like he was, you could see that.
Yeah, I don't know. I just wanted to see a breakdown of the stats or something because he wasn't breaking the line like, you know, Steve Menzies was or, you know, that sort of thing. And but universally admired as one of the greats.
But so that's where we're at in 94. Canberra and Brisbane absolutely dominating. And Ricky Stewart gradually winning the mantle as, you know, the best halfback and one of the best players in the game. I said 94 was the peak of talk about Langer and Stewart, but I think I misspoke there because I think the actual peak took place on the 4th of August 1993. So I'm just going to read this out and see if you agree with me. Sir, Ricky Stewart is one of the greatest players in the world and can do everything just as good, if not better, than Langer. First of all, Mr. Tusker wasn't being disloyal to Alan Langer. He was just telling the truth with his story about Ricky. Ricky was on two Man of the Match awards and going for his hat-trick against West when he was given a rest, since they were flogging the Magpies by so much. Langer fans think Ricky wouldn't be able to play against class players like Jared McCracken, but what did Langer do in the tests? He jinked back inside a couple of times. As Mr. Tasker said, imagine the havoc there would be if Meninga, Clyde, Khan and Lindner were running wide and Ricky cutting out six men with his 35-metre passes. Face it, Langer lovers, Stewart should be the Australian halfback. A. Paskin, Toronto, New South Wales. So I should add, Andrew, that actually got letter of the week in the Rugby League week, so congrats on that.
13-year-old psychopath.
So tell me about your mindset at the time.
I remember not being. I've come around to Alan Langer as an adult that he probably is the better player.
Does more than just jinx back inside a couple of times.
As a child, I was like, "What is this bloke doing? He can't kick, he can't pass. He keeps getting tackled on the fifth, trying to jinx back inside." I was just like, I couldn't believe it. I was like, and these idiots want him in the Australian side when this guy is dominating the game. I couldn't believe it. So I must write a letter to the editor. But that goes to show what sort of bloke I was and still am.
Well, I want to stay on this because you've got some form in this area. you were very invested in rugby league at the time, and particularly in your favourite player, Ricky Stewart. So, long-time listeners might have heard this before, but I really want you to tell me what you would do if, for instance, there was doubt over whether Ricky Stewart might be playing that week.
I think this was 94 I did this, and I just thought it was the most normal thing in the world to do. So I'm sitting at home one day and around the grounds or something was on, and they're saying, Stewart might be back for next week or something like that, and I couldn't believe it. I was like, I've got to find out. I mean, it's a whole week away, and I can't wait that long. So I thought, I'll ride down to the local post office and find the phone number in Canberra for the Canberra Raiders trainer, Sean McRae, who was mentioned quite heavily in the media at the time because he was an Australian trainer. Lo and behold, the McRae's in Canberra. Give them a ring up and S and someone McRae and a middle-aged woman answers the phone. I said, hello, I'm calling from New South Wales. I just want to know if you had any information if Ricky Stewart's playing this weekend. And she said, you've called our house. And I said, look, I'm really sorry about that, but, you know, I just got to know, is she went around? And, no, he's out. So I got to go. All right. No help from Mrs. McRae.
Do you remember if he ended up playing?
I don't, actually. But I remember telling that story to my friends and then going, what the bloody hell did you do that for? And I was like, you know, so I'll give him a ring.
I think it's. I would never have thought to do that. So I got to hand it to you. I think it's genius.
That's a troubled kid.
But it's funny because when you first told me that story, after I'd finished, getting myself off the floor from cracking up, I thought I couldn't have named a trainer of a team in 1994. You know,
well, it would have been 95 or 96 for you at that age. When you were 14.
Yeah, but still, even then, I don't think it was something I would have, you know, you hear about, you know, Ronnie Palmer or whatever, you know, you hear names, but I wouldn't have.
It was only because it was always he was in the Australian squad and they'd say Bomber McRae and.
Well, this is, when I was reading, preparing for this episode, reading all the old media from the time, it was astounding how much Sean McRae was in the press.
Yeah, he was a key part of the squad.
Yeah, and, you know, Tim Sheens gave him all the credit for it. There was a lot of talk that Canberra's training methods were advanced compared to other teams. There was a kind of myth that they were getting help from the AIS.
That's got to be one of the great conspiracy theories.
So I think they were sharing facilities early in the piece. But
do you mean that hugely successful organization, the AIS, that had three bronze medals in 48 years?
So by 94, that they were completely separate. So
the fact he did a good job when he had people ringing his house. Meanwhile, I BMX down to the post office to retrieve the number, call it from the phone box like a Unabomber. But.
So, this obsession effectively killed your active support for Canberra for a while, a couple of years after.
Well, this is 94 as well. We'll probably get to this game, the Brett Mullins 4-try game. Went in there with a kid from school that broke my shoulder playing football. 93-kilo kid in year 7. Thanks very much. But we went to the game, and I had a little system where I'd sneak down into the players' area, the visiting players' area. So the security guards weren't too bright in those days. Now, these days, they're geniuses, obviously. But like, there's just some bloke just like looking around, like off of the pixies. So I'd just be in my jersey, and I'd just walk straight down to the players' area, right near where the players run out. And I'd just sit, and there was loads of spare seats in the away team's area. So I sat down. I was in my Canberra jersey. They thought I was probably a relative or something. So I'm getting all the autographs. Everyone's signing the cards. Laurie Daly, Mal, heaps of guys signed. It was awesome. And I'm standing there in a Canberra Raiders hat, Canberra Raiders socks, and a New South Wales Blues jersey with Stuart and 7 on the back. And Stuart's standing there doing nothing, sort of like maybe looking at a bit of paper or something or a clipboard. He had like Socconi running shoes with his socks and his full kit on. So he's ready to play way early, like 2 hours early, but with his Socconi running shoes. They were odd-looking shoes. And I said, oh, Ricky Stewart, I'm a really big fan. Do you mind signing my cards? Turns slightly, looks at me and goes, after the game, mate, walks off. Devastated. So after that, I still supported them for like 94. And then by 95, I'm going to about 15. I'm like, God, the fucking prick. Like, and signed my cards. Like, Steve Walters signed my cards in the car park. He was driving his Saab with his missus. He must have driven to the game from Canberra. I don't know why. I flagged Steve Walters down and he signed through the car window. Yeah.
So we actually had someone recount that story to Laurie Daly. A third party did it on our behalf recently.
Friend of the show and Fox Sports personality, Andrew Barney Barnett. Yeah. He's a stand-up comedy buddy of mine. Great bloke.
So he recounted the story of your harassment of the McRae family. So Laurie, laughed with bemusement and said, really, haha, you forget how big of a tragic some of these people really are.
That hurts. Laurie on the money as usual.
Yeah.
We had the pleasure of meeting Laurie after the professor's late hit taping. Great bloke.
What an absolute legend of a bloke.
Remember I was saying to you how proud I was of myself. I never bailed him up at Northbridge Anytime Fitness.
Yeah.
Later on, I realized I already had bailed him up. I had to tell him that he did a gig with my mate, James Smith, who's a comedian, his corporate gig. And he goes, oh, yeah, right, good. So I had bailed him up. So that pride was... was non-founded.
Yeah, but what a great bloke he was. So we mentioned it, at the start of our first episode, 94 as being this high watermark. When we told Laurie about what we were doing, and we mentioned we were starting with a 94 recap, you could see his eyes light up, and he actually said, "Oh, I think that was about the best time for rugby league. It was, it was a really good era." And you could see him deflate when we mentioned we were going to be spending a year talking about Super League.
Absolutely. A face like a smack bum after we mentioned that. We've said on this show many times, like, one of the great rugby league guys because A, near immortal, B, just a genuine bloke.
Yeah. Yeah. So, as we said, 94, he missed quite a bit of football with that knee injury, which would go on to plague his career. And it was the start of, or maybe not even the start, it probably been happening for a couple of seasons, but a lot of talk among fans and sections of the media that he was like not putting in for the Raiders. He was saving himself for the big representative matches.
Like, that was I think that was unfair.
Mm.
I don't think he was that sort of guy.
No, I don't think so at all.
I think he was struggling.
Yeah, yeah. And then you had the push and pull of country wanted him to play, the Raiders didn't want him to play, and he was damned either way, basically.
Would you say that City Country was Mickey Mouse at that stage?
Yeah, It totally was. I've had it for later in the show, but we might as well talk about it now.
Yeah.
So Kevin Neal basically came over this Laurie Daly selection furor, where he played country, got hurt, you know, missed the Raiders' next game. Kevin Neal came out and said, like, why are we doing this? It's not a genuine selection trial. It's passé. And, you know, that was echoed by, you know, several in the media. And yet we persisted with it for another 20-plus years.
I was one of the guys saying, we need to keep it going.
And I understand the sentiment, but that's all it is.
Yeah.
The sentiment. It wasn't a genuine game since, you know, the early 90s at latest.
Again, with the Mickey Mouse, once it's over the Mickey Mouse cliff, it's done. Because it could have been something great.
Yeah. Well, but no, because it had its day. It served a very important place in rugby league for a long time. But by the 90s and, you know, even the 80s, there was no one being picked for Australia or New South Wales from the bush anymore.
But like, still, it could have been like Origin, where your Origin.
And I guess the argument is, like, you know, Queensland, you know, laugh at blokes bashing themselves up for city country only to, you know, play together, you know, the next week for Origin. You can make the same case for New South Wales and Queensland then feeding into Australia. I mean, we'll have more Laurie Daly talk as our discussion of the season goes on.
I think it was peak Daly.
Yeah, I think so too. He was my, as I told him, when we met him, he was my absolute hero at that point.
Some people are tragic, mate.
So let's talk about some of the young guns and less established blokes in that team, starting with Brett Mullen. So it's easy to forget that at the start of 1994, it wasn't even a guarantee that he was going to be starting fullback for the Raiders, let alone how he ended the year.
He was an enigmatic centre in 93.
Mm.
Winger.
Yeah. And so it's not like he came from nowhere. Like, he played for country in 92, Origin reserve in 93. So he was in the mix. He was a known prospect. But he went from being a kind of question mark, and that's in part to do with some of his off-field stuff, which could have ended in him being booted by the Raiders at one point early in his career.
What about the fact that we know as kids that he's up to no good without any actual stories about it?
Yeah.
So, like, how bad have you got to be for it to seep through that deep?
Yeah, yeah. You know, obviously known as a talented player, but question marks at the start of the year. So by the end of the year, being talked about in the same breadth as all these blokes who'd been established for years, like, his name was just right up there with anyone else in the game.
The guy outshone Steve Renoff.
Yeah.
And if you can do that,
yeah,
you're doing okay.
And watching Steve Renoff highlights for that year, like, he was still well and truly Steve Renoff.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, my God.
94 was, like, peak Renoff.
Yeah. It's funny, both of them in that same era, that same Australian team. Like, Renoff, like, had the Gaznia kind of, like, gear shift.
Yeah.
Mullen's more the Langlands kind of swerve.
But it was compared to Steve Rogers a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
We give Great Britain and England a hard time. How the hell are you going to stop those guys? I mean, think about it.
But so 1994 was very much the coronation of Brett Mullins. You know, it wasn't necessarily a long reign. I don't want to rehash our many Hall of Fame arguments, but one of the most exciting times for me watching rugby league was Brett Mullins in his pomp.
Like Nixon with the racial comments on the Nixon tapes, you're on record arguing for Brett Mullins not to be a Hall of Famer.
I don't think I ever said he's not a Hall of Famer. I had, I think, legitimate question marks.
Don't want to rehash it.
Yeah, let's cut it off now. Anyone who is interested can go back and listen to it, but we'll be going for another 3 hours if we start it now. So he went from an 80-1 shot to win the Rothmans at the start of the year to into, like, almost equal favouritism, like, by the end.
Wish I had a piece of that.
Of course, many people had a piece on David Fairley getting the early mail.
Do you reckon the mail come from his stable hands, his giant horse head?
You know, and going on that run, 11 tries in 3 games.
Well, Laurie Daly brought that up on his own bat.
Yeah.
Recount of the conversation when Michael and I bailed up Laurie Daly the other night.
Yeah.
Talking about 94 and Brett Mullins. How was Brett Mullins? And Daly goes, he scored 11 tries in 3 games that year. Like, he was blown away by it.
I know, eh? Yeah. For anyone who thinks that now the RLD and Laurie Daly are best mates, we've now literally recounted every single thing that was said between us and Laurie Daly. So.
Thanks to Andrew Barnett for setting that up.
Um, So, one thing I want to say about Brett Mullins as fullback was very, very perceptive, or very interesting comment from Tim Shanes, who was talking about his emergence and having Ken Nagus there at the same time, coming after, you know, a very successful era with Gary Belcher and Chicka Ferguson. When Gary was there, the players were always confident he would take the kick and bring it back. If you have a good fullback who gets involved, it's as if you're playing with 14 men. If not, you're playing with 12. We always had 14 men with Belcher and Chicka. Now with Brett and Chicka too, Nagus, it's the same.
See, Belcher was a gun in his own right.
Yeah.
He just, he wasn't Brett Mullins like in that, like, length of the field stuff. But as a fullback, he was amazing.
But it's funny because you think of fullbacks in that era. And yes, you had your absolute stars of the game, like Gary Belcher, Gary Jack. But teams could carry a fullback that was, like, just okay, just serviceable, just solid. It wasn't like the glamour position it is today.
This is the actual start of that.
Yeah.
It's like, everyone needs Brett Mullins now.
Yeah, exactly.
I put Julian O'Neill in the Belcher class. Really good, really solid, good player. You know, Mullins was just like a second Renoff.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, Julian O'Neill was a class player. It would have been interesting to see if he, you know, had a head on his shoulders, where he would have ended up.
The old cranium.
So, Mullins was late to the piece in making his Origin debut when both New South Wales and Queensland selectors went with one of the most conservative selections for Game 1. There was only one player who hadn't played in the previous year's season series among the 34 players picked. When New South Wales lost, with the likes of Nagus and Mullins and a whole bunch of other good young players coming through, it led to an outcry for some new blood.
Do Blues selectors jerk off to the word incumbent? Yeah. I mean, like, they've never, ever gone out of the box.
Mm. So they were forced to in Game 2, not so much because of the media and public clamouring, but because Bob Fulton decided that he didn't have the Australian team he wanted yet. So he basically demanded new blood in the New South Wales team, got his wish, as was the way things were done in those days. And so Mullins and Nagus both made their debuts in Game 2.
Mullins and Nagus felt a marionette string on their on the back of their neck, and they were fine.
So let's move on to Ken Nagus, and we'll do him and Nandruku as a package deal, because that was just electric having both of those guys in that team.
See, I was big on Nandruku after his debut, and he was just bamboozling guys with the twinkle toes. And when Kenny Nagus came on the scene, I was like, well, he's not as good as Nandruku. And then, hang on, this guy's an absolute Ferrari.
Yeah.
Poetry.
Yeah.
As opposed to the battering ram and the footwork, he was just swerve and speed.
And it's funny because at the start of the year, it was viewed that he was a real contender for the Raiders' fullback job.
And he would have been majestic as a fullback.
That's what you wonder, like, where those two careers go if they had, you know, broken it down that way. You'd think Mullins probably would have ended up playing centre in 95 with Mal gone.
Yeah. It's embarrassment of riches.
Yeah. Especially considering when Nagus was injured for partway through the year, Albert Fulavai came in.
Who was also good.
And there was talk that Nagus would have to, you know, get back into the team through reserve grade. So good was he going.
How good was the Raiders' reserve grade team?
Yeah. But Noah Nandruku experienced a bit of second-year syndrome in 1994, had some injury problems, appeared a bit jaded in the press, wasn't the easygoing kind of fella that everyone loved in 1993.
He put on a bit of size in 94.
Mm.
He was a lot skinnier in 93.
And there was talk of a contract dispute as well. He wasn't happy with his deal at the Raiders. So it took him quite a while to get his way into the season.
And didn't he get into it towards the end?
Another player who really emerged in 1994 was Jason Croker, who probably the unluckiest, kangaroo omission that year.
I remember being really upset by that. You know, nepotism, one of my worst things in the world. But they were vindicated with David Ferner's career.
Yeah. I mean, but they would have equally been vindicated with Jason Croker there.
True.
Especially as a utility.
Desperately unlucky.
So Tim Sheens was pushing his case from very, very early in the piece, and, you know, especially talking about him as that utility option. When you look at Jason Croker's career, the spread of games he played, 318 games, I'm going to read out by position. So 10 games off the bench, which that itself, for someone who's considered a utility's utility to play 318 games and only 10 of them off the bench.
Amazing.
One game at fullback, 44 games at wing, 48 at center, 58 at 5'8", one at prop, 49 at second row, 108 at lock.
Amazing.
So my question's kind of answered in that breakdown, but do you think he's a natural lock? Do you think that's his best position?
Back row anywhere.
Yeah.
It's like towards the end he was playing middle.
Yeah.
Anyway, but I just love the guy and respect him so much for holding the team together towards the end when it was just diabolical.
Yeah.
And they had these disgusting jerseys.
You mean the Oracle era?
Yeah. And like, he was the glue.
Yeah.
Otherwise, the whole thing was going to come down. Mm. And also the story of him holding himself up on the goalposts horizontally with his arms. I mean, the core strength of this bloke. He's an example of what you get when you work as hard as you can. You know, they get the maximum out of your body. So when he finished, he was like a giant ball of muscle.
Mm.
Where some guys like Anthony Milford looks like a year five kid. Yeah. He's been playing 8 years of first grade. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Because, yeah, he was picked quite a lot at wing in those early years.
Well, he was a lot smaller back then.
Yeah.
I don't think he was much of a winger, to be honest. It's just solid.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, winger, he's kind of plugged in, you know, doing a job rather than, you know, playing to his strengths. But I wanted to ask you this. So, you know, he's probably, lock's probably his best position. Is that true of any genuine utility?
Well, I wanted to bring up before, we were talking like last episode about Brad Fittler. He's in the Rugby League Lock of the Year discussion.
I think he won it that year in 94.
Yeah. So
I think he was center 92, 93, lock 94, something like that.
I loved him as a lock.
Yeah.
And I would like to know what he thought his best position was.
I can tell you because I've got that quote. So in 1994, when there was talk, which we're going to get to, as to whether Mal Meninga was going to keep his place in the Australian team with Brad Fittler, with Steve Renoff, there was talk that, you know, Fittler might, you know, be there as a center, but then they ended up picking him at lock. And he actually said, I think it's my best position, and I really think from here on out, this is where I'll end up playing all my footy.
I wish he did. He was great at 5'8", though. He had the size, and he had the lower body strength. Yeah. And
what a crazy career he had.
My all-time favorite Australian team was the era when the back row was Lidner, Clyde, and Fittler at lock.
Mm.
That was absolutely killer. It had every type of back rower covered.
Yeah. But the other thing I wanted to ask about utilities is, does the hooker half thing, does that count as a utility?
I've always hated it.
Yeah.
Mark Soden started it.
Mm.
In my view, it should have ended there. But I really hated the bastardizing the halfback position. Yeah.
And I always think in most respects, or in most instances, it's a waste of the bench spot in the representative teams anyway, you know?
Agreed. But in saying that, I think Craig Gower was a better hooker.
Yeah. Well, yeah, but that's the thing. You're either one or the other.
Yeah.
But picking the guy and calling him a utility when he's just either a halfback or a hooker.
You want a utility like Jason Croker.
Yeah.
Who can literally play.
Yeah, exactly. Anyway. When I think utility, that's what I think of, a Jason Croker. And we've talked about the pack a bit. We mentioned David Ferner. Let's not forget that he did emerge. It wasn't as if, like, just Winnie McClive Churchill put him on the plane and nothing else, you know. He'd been talked about throughout that year as, you know, a real chance.
He was a tough guy and he had actual footwork,
yeah,
which was quite new.
Mm. Yeah, so with him, with Ponga and Lomax and that, you know, really good bench of Hetherington and Wesley, like, the pieces were all in place.
Hetherington was like, he's a definition of what they used to describe as raw boned.
Yeah.
Wouldn't like to tackle him. John Daly mullet.
The last player I want to talk about before we move to the Mal Meninga farewell tour is Ruben Wiki, and specifically the off-field issue that dogged him all year, which was the contract drama, the tug of war between Canberra and Auckland.
He got out of that with the inverse homesickness.
Yes. His teammates were calling him Ruben Witch City by the end of the year.
What a G-up!
So, yes, so he signed a contract with Auckland, then went on to sign a different contract with Canberra. His argument was that the stipulation in his Auckland contract was, I'm signing, but I'm just signing that I'll come to you if I can't come to terms with Canberra, which, even among rugby league contracts, I don't think I've seen a clause that ludicrous.
It's possible. Now, did the Canberra administration get round to signing this one? Unlike the
unlike the Wayne Bennett contract, yeah, they did, and went to great lengths to prevent the Auckland contract from happening, to the point where they changed Ruben Wickie's phone number so the Auckland officials couldn't contact him.
Fair dinkum.
When asked about this story, Kevin Neal said, "Why wouldn't we? Auckland have harangued him for 6 months before and since his signing."
But what about the fact that they've got to change his number for him? He's incapable of bringing up the phone company. But I remember when this was happening, I was going like, what are Auckland doing trying to brand and operate? Like, we've got like every international in the world and they want one good young kid. I remember thinking about the name when I heard it in the teams. So I'm like, Ruben Wickie, it's a weird name, Ruben. And then like I saw him play, I'm like, Jesus. He's smashing guys from the outset. It's like...
His argument for why he wouldn't go is that he was browbeaten or, you know, lent on to sign the Auckland contract. That argument was weakened by the fact that he actually posted his contract to New Zealand from Canberra. So, yeah, had some time in the interim to... and, you know, his final word on the subject was, "I won't be playing with the Warriors. I admit I've messed things up by signing with two clubs, and I'm embarrassed by what has happened. But what I do know is that I want to stay in Canberra."
It's irrefutable evidence, and if you want to stay there, just stay there. But this is not even in the top 10 of like rugby league contract debacles. No. So, like, you know, as soon as someone doesn't want to be there, like, who doesn't want to be? Brian Kearney in Titans is number one.
But what are rugby league clubs supposed to do? Because that's the thing. If he doesn't want to be there, he's not going to put in. You might as well let him go. But then you let him go and then you're just paving the way for future backflips and clauses and everything else we've seen.
If I was a rugby league administrator, I'd make him sit out the year. Mm. Okay, right?
Yeah.
You've got to learn the value of a contract, boys.
So let's turn to Mal, you know, playing his last season. And as I said, there were genuine question marks at the start of the year as to whether he belonged in the Queensland and Australian teams.
We both love Mal more than anybody in this podcast, but what an absolute... It was a fairy tale. Trope. It is the trope.
Yeah.
He finished it perfectly on every level.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, obviously, Queensland had the series defeat, but, you know, that was in no way because of him. Like, the stats showed that in game one, he was, you know, one of the most heavily involved players. Obviously, played a key part in the final try. More than justified his selection.
Yeah.
Apart from anything else, like, he got the ending he deserved, especially with the Kangaroo Tour.
And we still kept hearing about it even in that year. "You come back from these broken arms."
Yeah.
I'm so glad we're still hearing about that.
But one corner where the criticism made its way into, you know, a bit of tension was Wally Lewis, Queensland coach, not expressly backing him. He was on a Channel 7 program and asked of whether Mal would be in the Queensland team. So Wally Lewis wasn't a selector of the team. So he said this: "Everybody in the team's under the microscope from the selectors. We can only, I suppose, bank on the performances on the field from him. If the selectors believe that's good enough, then fine. I'm out there to coach the football team. And if Mal's in it, well, certainly. You know my opinion that he can hold himself in State of Origin football pretty well. Well, I'll coach him. If he's not in the side, I'll coach the guy who's replacing him. I'll leave that decision to the selectors."
Is there anybody that handled the media worse than Wally Lewis? Like, from the 80s till, like, recently, terrible. Now he's good. But
I mean, I can see what he was trying to get at. Like, just saying, it's not my decision. I'm the coach. I'll coach
you. But you know what rugby league players are like?
Yeah.
One little perceived slight and the whole deck of cards comes in.
It was always going to be that way. I meant to do some research in this, but I didn't. But I always get the sense that Wally and Mal were never like super tight.
Yeah, maybe a bit of like ego. I'm better than you. You're better than you're not better than me.
Obviously, a lot of like mutual respect and shared successes and all the rest of it. I don't think it's a feud.
Yeah,
but I don't know. Just the sense I get is they, you know, did different types.
I'm just happy they both made immortality because they both deserved it.
Yeah, great ending for Mal, and that whole year became, you know, one long farewell tour with a lot of highs along the way. One of the lows came at a tribute night to Mal Meninga. And I'll just read this. This is from a Sherlock column. "Watson tells me that the performance by former St. George icon Rod Rocket Reddy at the Mal Meninga tribute dinner the other night was about as tasteful as a freak show. The old boy suggested that the Rocket should stick to coaching and leafing through his scrapbook after a foul-mouthed effort as a speaker at the dinner." And what's more, said Watson, the whimsical Peter Jacko Jackson wasn't all that much better telling off-colour honeymoon jokes, which such an occasion could have well done without. Jacko also strayed across the line and into dangerous territory by sniping at one famous guest, former PM Bob Hawke.
Oh, that's awesome.
But funnily enough, in that same piece, praise was given on Paul Vorton, who managed to save proceedings in some way with a professional, amusing, a speech that matched the occasion.
Yeah.
So it's funny that couple of years of media training did its work, because it was at a Wally Lewis tribute dinner in 1990 that he got on stage and told a joke about Wally Lewis taking shits in his teammates' dressing rooms as a G-up. You know?
It's madness. Peter Jackson was the best.
Yeah. And so a lot of positivity coming Mal's way. Laurie Daly for Mal's last home game, like, probably shouldn't have been on the field, battling an injury. But he said, if it had not been Mal's farewell game, I would not have played. I really wanted to be a part of it. Mal's such a good bloke. He helped a lot of the guys at Cameron. I want a bit to be out there to say thanks.
It's awesome.
Mm. And Wayne Bennett with some very perceptive comments. This was in the wake of everyone bagging out Mal and, you know, debating his place in the team. Just about every year in State of Origin, someone says they should get rid of Mal. You watch next year. They'll be saying, if only Mal was still there.
Yep.
And, I mean, there are a myriad number of reasons why Canberra haven't won a comp since Mal left. He's probably not even the chief among them. But the fact is, they haven't. They haven't gone back to a grand final.
You know what he gave you? We talked about this off air the other day, but he was the biggest guy in his position by a long way for a long time. Mm. So now everyone's as big as Mal, but back then they weren't.
Yeah.
So he's always imposing. But he was a winner, and he's a leader, and he just felt confidence. When Mal's on the side, there was confidence.
Yeah.
If you had Steve Renoff there with someone else, not quite as good.
Mm. Yeah.
Steve Renoff's not quite as free to do his thing because Mal's not there.
Yeah.
Taking up all the players away from him and stuff.
Before we move on from Mal, one question I had. So Don Ferner came out in, you know, at some point during the year talking about the influence he had and what an important signing there was. He likened it to Arthur Beetson coming to the Roosters in the early 70s. But since then, in our era, can you think of a more influential signing by any club or anything even comparable?
I shudder to think where they'd be, if they'd be,
yeah,
without that signing.
Because I really struggle to think of a signing that had the impact that him going to Canberra had.
This goes to show you, he's a generational talent. It's like, you know, go back to the NBA all the time. He's like the LeBron of the era, like 1980, when he came out as a young kid. It was like, look at this guy. Something else. G.I.
Yeah.
It's freakish, to quote Joey. It's a freak athlete.
On the other side of things was Terry Lamb, who at that stage was also, it was widely viewed that he was going to be retiring at the end of the year.
I used to hate Terry Lamb.
I hated him so much.
But I also admired him, and now I love him, right?
Yeah, yeah. I've had the same kind of path with Terry Lamb.
But the idea of a guy, you know, this chunky little necklace terrier refusing to train, right? So, like, guys that beat the system, I love. Like, yeah. So he goes, look, I play better if I don't train. Yeah. They're like, okay, don't train then. So, like, how good would he have been if he did train? What would it have hurt him, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Some guys, they're better off not training, maybe. Yeah, exactly. Like, that just made me laugh so much.
But for all that, for the non-training, for the oddest-shaped body of, like, a rugby league player, like, he was quick. Like, he was, renowned as the king of backing up and all the rest of it.
I love that part about him, too. But, like, yeah. I would call him a footballer. Footballer's footballer, where it's like, that bloke's a footballer. Mm. Jason Smith. Guys that just get it done and they have time and stuff like that.
Yeah.
God, he's a good player. And, you know, compared to the dirty, get it, win at all cost type guy. Like,
yeah.
Amazing career.
So in the end, he broke his arm in 1994, which actually probably helped to prolong the career. He missed much of that season, came back late. And from there, any talk of retiring was put to bed. Maybe if they had gone on to win the comp, would have been a different story. But it gave him that other year and the chance to finish the career right. Obviously, he came back in 96 eventually, which we'll discuss in some detail later in our series. But in the wake of the early season talk about Terry Lamb potentially retiring, there was a lot of that same goodwill that Mal got and a lot of reflection over his career and his achievements. And a lot of talk about him and Cliff Lyons, who was in a similar stage of his career, how they were perpetually overshadowed for the rep scene, but that didn't diminish like the, you know, the height, the scope of their achievements and their place in the game.
Exactly. There was an era of the club man. Mm. I mean, they both had a couple of shots.
He actually made himself unavailable, like, from pretty early in the piece. Like, you know, in 88, he was, or 87, 88, he was saying he didn't want to play rep footy, you know.
It's odd, isn't it?
But look at his career achievements. So, Dally M 5-8 for the year, 83, 84, 86, 87, and then three straight from 91 to 93. He won the Dally M in 83, the Rothmans in 84. So, in that era of Lewis and Kenny, he was still, like, a dominant, dominant player.
Yeah, amazing.
I love Brett Kenny's actual talk about Terry Lamb. He said that he studied his game, like, closely, you know, and knew how good he was, and said, he rarely moves wider than 20 metres in from touch. That's how he's always where the action is, and that's how he's still playing at this age. Like, very kind of on the money way to think about how Terry Lamb played.
You're saying he didn't cover that many yards?
Yeah. Right. But he played in the middle and, you know, did all his damage there.
It felt like he was in everything.
Yeah.
You want him on your side, wouldn't you?
Mm.
You want him anywhere except the golf course.
Well, funnily enough, in 94, when he was very much almost like the coach on field sort of stage of his career, where, you know, it was a very inexperienced Canterbury team. He was the old hardhead. Coach Chris Anderson, assistant coach Steve Folkes, both players that he played with and experienced great success with, they actually had a weekly golf game on the Tuesday where they'd discuss, you know, the previous week's game and, you know, the game to come. And you'd love to be on the back of that golf cart, wouldn't you?
Just make sure you're not slowing down play in front of him.
But yeah, so he was the you know, the old hard-head experienced guy in the team. There was a lot of talk that he needed to do less work. You know, Steve Mortimer, I mean on field, not but yeah, Steve Mortimer came out and said that, you know, Bar, you need to slow down, you need to hand off some responsibility, you know. You had, you know, Craig Polamalu coming through, and I just don't think it was in Terry Lamb's nature to be able to do that. And Canterbury, actually, when all the talk was that they couldn't win without Terry Lamb, and the stats up to that point had showed that they couldn't, they actually went on a fairly good winning streak without him in the 10 or so weeks he was out. So that was kind of showing you that the team that they were building.
Watching the grand final, which we'll cover later on, I was blown away by how many good players they had too. Canterbury squad.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about a few more of those.
Even got like Jason Williams.
Yeah,
he was like a really good finisher.
He was the classic like brain explosion guy, would do dumb things, yeah, but like had that, you know, like flair.
Definitely expected.
Yeah. They got Darryl Halligan in that year from Norths, left Norths in acrimonious circumstances when
has anyone ever left Norths in any other way?
So Norths recruited Jason Taylor from West that year, or that off-season. And so even though Darryl Halligan had been the leading point scorer the 3 years prior, it was unlikely that there was going to be a first-grade spot for him because they had Sean Hoppy coming in.
Yeah.
They had Jason Taylor now who could do the kicking. So he fought and fought for his release, came over to Canterbury.
Best move of his career.
Yeah, absolutely. And you kind of, like, when you think of Darryl Halligan, all you think about is his goal kicking, and, you know, he was like kind of a pretty slow, serviceable at best kind of.
I used to really root for him as a winger.
Yeah.
Every time he scored, and he was quite a good finisher, big and strong.
I got to say, watching some of the highlights from 94, like, you forget that, like, he could play.
Yeah.
You know, he wasn't just a goal kicker, even though he was primarily a goal kicker.
It's just when you're not fast as a winger,
yeah,
people don't rate you.
Mm. Staying with the backs, you had the Darren Smith saga play out all year where he you know, basically said that he wasn't going to sign with Canterbury in 95, signed that letter of intent with the Crushers. There was, you know, various talk that he was going to end up at Parramatta before, you know, finally going to Brisbane.
What purpose is a letter of intent in rugby league? There is absolutely no reason to do them.
So Canterbury took a pretty harsh stance on the matter, and like he played very little part in the team throughout the back half of 94. He got on in the semi-final against Canberra, I think, but wasn't used in the grand final. You know, spent a lot of time in reserves. I just think it's a weird stance that clubs do that with some players and not others.
Yeah, agreed.
And it's a very Chris Anderson thing to do as well.
Chris Anderson got out of his coffin, his Dracula coffin, on the wrong side that day.
It's the Smith saga, which played out in the press for most of the year, led to one of my favourite quotes of the year, which came from Warren Ryan, who was talking about it. And he said, "When you're offside at Canterbury, you're offside." And I think as a global authority on being offside, Warren Ryan's words should be hated.
Yeah, if he's ruining them for their...
But it's funny that at the start of the year, Darren Smith was, you know, in the Queensland Origin team, if not likely, a very keen contender for a Kangaroo spot. His brother Jason was battling for a first grade spot. By the end of the year, those fortunes had been completely reversed.
Yeah.
I just wanted to talk about Chris Anderson for a bit. He's, as I said, really funny bloke.
Underrated coach. Record to die for. Just ended badly.
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, again, that first half record speaks for itself. Something interesting about Chris Anderson as a coach that came at... It was a Steve Mortimer column that year. He was talking about Anderson as a coach and Canterbury's style. And he said, you know, as someone who played with Chris Anderson, "Make no mistake, at Canterbury Bankstown, the year of 1980 and the year of 1984 were very distinct." First question, why don't we give them names, these two eras? You know, I think maybe it could really help clarify it in our mind what exactly he's talking about. But he went on to say that, you know, the premierships in each of those eras were very different, and Chris Anderson played in both of those eras, which I think means something. When a couple of months ago we were talking about the 95 squad and you asked if it was a Dogs of War or an Entertainers, and I said it was a bit of a tweener.
Yeah, yeah.
You can see that with the 94 squad as well. It's a real mix of...
But in saying that, most coaches want to have...
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean,
of defensive attack.
Obviously, in some ways, it goes without saying, but it does show you the character of that team. Like, I think the balance was really good.
Well, that's what the Raiders were.
Yeah.
Lomax and Ponga, etc.
Yeah, I mean, definitely they had that edge, but when I think of that Raiders team, I think 1-7, you know, like basically. But let's talk about some of those young guns coming through, starting with the Filthy Four. We'll call them the Filthy Three because McCracken, as your letter showed, was a well-established class player. But he was a class player.
Oh, I just really love him.
Like, the best elements of the classic power center and just the strike, you know, like the speed. Like,
you think of McCracken, you think of handful.
Mm, yeah.
Absolute handful. Yeah. Big friend.
Great Barnett on him.
Beautiful Barnett.
Let's stay on the Barnett talk. Jim Dimmick, 94, immaculate flat top.
Oh, yeah, Bruce Boland.
Yeah, loved Jim Dimmick's 94 look. Another question, read Jim Dimmick.
I'm one of my favourite players of all time.
Has there been a better exponent of the basketball pass than Jim Dimmick?
I reckon he was, Q&A was Michael Jordan,
yeah,
for sure. But, yeah, loved it.
And when was the last time you heard a commentator say basketball pass? Like...
Well, no one's doing it anymore.
No.
They used to literally, like, push it from the chest.
Yeah.
Gene Wiles used to...
It was a good era, the basketball pass era.
Now it's hold the ball in one hand and sort of around the corner. Mm.
But, yeah, so Jim Dimmick played a lot of that season at 5'8 with Terry Lamb injured.
God, he's a good player.
Yeah. Yeah.
Class.
Yeah.
A footballer's footballer.
Yeah. And another one of those guys that you kind of forget how good he was until you actually go back and start watching him.
Yeah. And we said it in our Hall of Fame discussions, underrated by rep selectors.
Yeah.
Even though he got a few goes, but should have had more.
And a lot of competition. So I wouldn't say he was necessarily unlucky, but it wouldn't have been out of place on that Kangaroo squad.
Yeah.
And in fact, his old South teammates, Terry Hill and Jim Sidaris, the three of them had kind of pledged to get on that plane together, and Dimmick was the one that missed out.
Shocker.
Mm. The other member of that quartet, Dean Pay, who'd been on the scene since 89, you know, he was 25 at the time. But
loved Dean Pay.
Really broke out that year, made his rep debut, and, you know, had everyone, you know, blocker enthusing about what a, you know, tough forward he was.
When you hear the old trope, no nonsense, that's Dean Pay.
Yeah, yeah. And the classic, like, born 35.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Guy. You know?
He made Webke look like a young man in the face. But he built that bond with Stuart on the 94 tour to become besties, roommates, as it were.
But yeah, I really liked what Phil Gould had to say about Dean. This was when it was Dean Pay was getting into that Origin team, and Phil Gould said that. So he was Canterbury coach at 89 when Dean Pay made his debut, and he said we were playing South and they had that pack, you know, Ian Roberts, Les Davidson, you know, David Boyle, etc. You know, a really tough pack, and you know, he threw Dean Pay in as a 19-year-old, and Dean Pay laconic. Just came off and said, you know what, it wasn't that tough out there, coach, you know. And leading up to the Origin debut, he was a bit nervous. And after the game, Phil Gould asked him how it was, and he was like, you know what, it wasn't that tough out there, coach.
When he was on the Blues side, I felt confident.
Yeah, yeah. I wanted to talk about Craig Polamalu a bit more, who I really like as a player. The classic thing that I hated him at the time, and if I hated you at that era, it probably meant you were a good player.
I hated him too, mainly because of the name. I hated the hyphenated name.
Yeah.
You know, it kind of works.
Yeah, well, he did have a rah-rah background.
That's what I mean. Yeah. That's what it felt like. It's like, no. But he's a good, tough player.
Yeah. The funny thing about he was injured early in the year and then had to fight his way back to first grade because Kevin Moore came in and was holding down the spot for about 10 weeks. So he spent much of that season in reserve grade. Kevin Moore was playing his last year then, after bouncing around at Canterbury, you know, playing mainly reserves for about a decade. He actually had an offer to go to Manly, but decided not to take it up because he had a job in the area. Obviously, there's the family connection there. It just made me think of that. That was the last bastion of that era of player.
Yeah.
The player where they're playing is a lifestyle thing as much as anything
yeah,
else.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, I'm happy to, you know, be club captain, play 200 games of reserve grade, the odd first when, you know, I get the opportunity. And
it's kind of admirable, but I would like to see him try his hand somewhere else. Yeah, he was a good player at times.
Yeah, yeah, I think I can't remember if it was Glenn Hughes or Stephen Hughes that was kind of that same mold and like...
All the Hugheses.
Yeah. But like, I think...
Except Corey. Corey
except went. Corey played, yeah. But yeah, like, reserve grade captain for like 10 years and...
I'd like to know where we're at with feuds in Canterbury. Like, are the Hughes in, are they out? Which ones are in, which ones are out? The Anderson clan.
Yeah, have you read Graham Hughes' book? It seems some of those scars are still quite fresh. So. but do you have anything else to say about the Canterbury squad?
Just that I was surprised at how... I mean, they weren't in the same class as Canberra due to... Canberra's magic salary cap work, but I thought they had a really good squad.
Yeah, yeah. And it's funny because that 95 team, like, I always felt they came out of nowhere. And I mean, they did that year, they finished seventh or whatever it was. But I mean, minor premiers in 93, grand finalists in 94.
Yeah, yeah.
Like,
they were just mainly in Canterbury in the mid 90s. The success ratio was crazy.
Mm.
But I love guys like Simon Gillies and like Darren Britt.
Yeah.
Rhyming slang these days, but they're good toilers, you know. I like the good hard toiler.
Yeah. Having, you know, Marty Beller in that team as well in 94. I didn't realize Craig Smith was there in 94.
I didn't know either, no. Yeah. Lifting the knees.
Yeah. but so anyway, so that is this week's episode. We'll be back to discuss the on-field season next week. For anyone who is wondering why we're 2 weeks into a Super League series and haven't mentioned Super League once, this just goes to show you how in-depth we're going to get here. So there's a lot of ground to cover. So I hope you're enjoying the ride as much as we are.
Toodaloo.
Or say who is after her ex. It can be Oedipus Rex, where a chap kills his father and causes a lot of bother. The clerk who is thrown out of work by the boss, who is thrown for a loss by the skirt, who is doing him dirt. The world is a the screen. A swain getting slain for the love of a queen. Some great Shakespearean scene where a ghost and a prince meet and everything ends in this mean. The gag may be waving the flag that began with the Mr. Cohan hip horror.